Доброго дня, шановні друзі.
Good afternoon, dear friends. We are starting our presentations of surveys of specific countries, and we will start from the survey of how Ukraine is perceived in Japan. I am Nadia Kavaль, the head of the Information Analytical Department of Ukrainian Institute. I would like to present the participants. This is the Mr. Sergei Korsunsky, the ambassador of Ukraine to Japan. Next to me is Sergei Gerasimchuk, the Deputy Executive Director of the Analytical Center Ukrainian Prisma. Violeta Udovik, the Second Secretary on Cultural, Humanitarian Cooperation of the Embassy of Ukraine in Japan. She was the respondent, not the participant of our today's discussion, is a famous writer, Andrei Kurkov. His works were translated into Japanese as well. And also we have a wonderful participant, Mr. Takashi Hirano, head of a Japanese section of Ukrinform. And I believe that in this wonderful panel, we will discuss the results of our survey, and we will together think of what is the perception of Ukraine and Ukrainian culture in Japan, and how to develop cultural diplomacy. First of all, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Ambassador, so that he talks about whether such surveys are really needed and what his impressions are on how Ukraine is perceived in Japan. And I would like to ask Mr. Korsunsky how the embassy could use the results of this survey in their work. Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you. I am sorry for being the first in 20 minutes. I have to be on a different online event. So Violeta knows the situation well. We work together on issues of how to present Ukraine in Japan. I would like to thank you so much. We were so much interested in this survey, in this idea on surveying how Japan perceives Ukraine. And Madam Bareika said it correctly, that people say that in Japan, people like classics. I will talk about that. We are very much interested in the embassy. I was interviewed also, and Violeta was interviewed, and many interesting people in Japan participated in that. I wanted to start from some provocative theses. So that when I leave you, the discussion goes even deeper. When we find out that some country doesn't know Ukraine, that's not always our fault. This could be the fault of that country, or maybe the tradition of the country. In this case, once we're talking about Japan, we need to take into account the fact that whatever we talk about Ukraine, Japanese are Japanese-centric. They believe that their country is country which is self-sufficient. They are open to other cultures, but for this message to reach them, it should be in Japanese language. And it should be in Japanese language, which was learned in Japan, because the language is very complicated. I can give you millions of examples. Within this half a year, I'm trying to learn Japanese. My colleagues are helping me. I will go to language courses, but when you open our Japanese textbooks, what they write there has nothing to do with how these words are used in Japan. This is a very serious barrier. That is why what we are doing now in social media We work via social media because this COVID period is what we are tired of, but we can quite efficiently use Twitter to promote Ukrainian culture, and we do that in Japanese. Same thing on the website of the embassy, on the Twitter of the embassy, we do it all in Japanese. It's not always possible to have an ideal translation, but that's a very important aspect. And also we need to understand. I know that Ukrainian Institute was doing a lot, Dacha Bracha, and our Onuka, other things that we like, maybe Europe likes them, but in Japan they don't need it. In Japan they love classics. They love their own classics. And their Japanese arts are so popular. It's unbelievable how they preserve every tradition, how they make the dolls, the clothes, the traditions, garments. That is so specific, and they value when other countries doing the same in relation to their values. It is important to have books. Japan is the country that reads. I'm just enjoying it. In the morning, I get two paper newspapers, which smell of printing house, bookstores. First of all, these are absolutely beautiful premises, very comfortable with internet, and they're full of people who have coffee and read books, and they buy many books. Unfortunately, we requested for a small support for publishing one Ukrainian fairy tale that was translated already, but we did not get any funding for that. There should be books, there are books, but there should be some program. Then in Japan, cuisine is very popular. I know Ukrainian Institute published books about Ukrainian cuisine. Please, I beg you, send them to us. I bought two Ukrainian books on Ukrainian cuisine in English, and some people are planning to open the Ukrainian restaurant. You know, when we were organizing the competition on Ukrainian borscht, many Japanese were asking me, we want to taste it, we want to have it. It's great that you did that in Ukrainian Institute. Please continue. Then positive is needed. You Japanese are people who are tuned to positive. They want to have a beautiful fairy tale. We have this woods fairy, forest fairy, Ukrainian fairy tale. Let's translate it into Japanese. This will be much better understood than other super modern things. Then I need to tell that I was impressed. We had a campaign. Ministry of Foreign Affairs organized it. We had many information campaigns, Days of Shevchenko, Days of Lesser Ukrainka, and what refers to Crimea. And they give us such a message. You probably saw that. If you write Crimea in English and you delete letter A, then this will be crime. And that was like a message, the text about Crimea without the letter A. That's just a wonderful hint. It's great. Now, put yourselves into the shoes of Japanese. What about letter A? You delete it, how will Japanese guess what you have done? This is absolutely different language, absolutely different approach. And that's true not just about Japan. I was impressed. I need to tell about that. It's not a criticism. I understand that this would be the message for Europe. But when you do such things, please take these things into account. You need to understand there are other cultures which are absolutely different than ours. Japan is a different planet. If we want to be present there, we need to take that into account. If we want to send such messages, they are to be developed with the participation of Japanese, who know how Japanese will perceive this message. For them, Crimea and crime is the same. Most of Japanese do not speak English. That's what I wanted to express as the proposal for discussion. Again, I am absolutely, I absolutely appreciate Ukrainian Institute, Prisma, who participated in that. That's important for us. We will use it. I will stop here. Thank you. I'm so sorry that I will not hear the whole panel. I will stay for another 10 minutes, but with such partners on the panel, I'm happy to see Andriy Kurkov and also Mr. Hirana, whose advice I take into account. So I thank you all. Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for finding time to speak here. But I would like to say that the respondents in Japan mentioned the active role of the Embassy of Japan in the development of cultural diplomacy. Now we will request Mr. Sergei Gerasimchuk, one of co-authors of the survey. Please tell us briefly about the main results and conclusions of your survey. What is the image of Ukraine and perception of Ukrainian culture in Japan? Thank you. I would like to thank those who organized this project, the Ukrainian Institute, the International Renaissance Foundation. That was quite an interesting period in life of our team, because the project was very interesting, but on the other hand, it was a very serious challenge. We had to find approaches to respondents. I'm happy that we managed to do that. I would like to thank our team, the team of Ukrainian Prisma, that implemented the project. And also, I would like to thank all the panelists, most of who participated in the project, the Ambassador Violeta and Takashi Hirano, who also helped us with the contacts and who gave us a lot of good advice. That was very important. And another appreciation and thanks to Anastasia, who was doing all the interviews and all the respondents. There's a big story behind each one of them. I was lucky to talk to our diaspora, Anastasia, representatives of Japan, but every person was a history. It was interesting to find about the history of these people and their role in how Ukraine is perceived in Europe. And now as to results. First one, everything's bad. Very few people know about Ukraine and Japan. The knowledge is quite limited. Even the experts had some difficulties with talking about Ukraine with knowledge and non-experts, sometimes even doubt that Ukraine is a state. They are not sure where geographically Ukraine is located, and that is a big, that's negative for bilateral relations. And that is where we have this quotation that Japanese know little about Ukraine, and probably you can find those who do not know where geographically Ukraine is located. The second conclusion, that everything is not just bad, but very bad, because they perceive Ukraine via Russian context, and that is what Nadia Bureka mentioned already, and I can confirm that from the interviews we conducted. Very often, Russia dominates, and Ukraine is considered to be almost like Russia. There are several reasons to that. And hypothetically, we can say that, first of all, that's language. Japanese, there are more Japanese who know Russian than Ukrainian. And that is why Ukraine is perceived via Russian media. And Russians don't write a lot of good things about Ukraine. Also, what we saw in the US, but in the US said that, that was the past. These are scientists, the experts in Soviet times, so-called Sovietologists, and they talk about Ukraine based on their knowledge of the times of the Soviet Union. Besides that, there's a lack of information. One of my respondents even mentioned that when in Ukraine Putin was replaced by Medvedev, someone asked him, "Are you?" Someone asked this person from Ukraine, "Are you happy that you have a new president now?" Basically, another conclusion is that some attributes of Ukrainian culture are believed to be Russian. Respondents many times were talking about borscht. Borscht is not just warfare in Europe between Ukraine and Russia. They argue about borscht in Japan. And what is obvious for us, that borscht is Ukrainian. But in Japan, they very often talk about that as about Russian soup. And our Ukrainian community was writing letters to Japanese producers that this is not Russian soup. And they found the agreement, and now they write that that's Ukrainian dish. What has changed?
Starting 2014, when the war broke out, there was more attention to what happens in Ukraine, and this fact, paradoxically, became positive. Ukraine was differentiated by Russia. They started to differentiate it from the Soviet Union, that we even have war with Russia, and if Ukraine fight, it means it's dangerous, and sometimes we have problems with students' exchange because not all teachers advise students to travel to Ukraine because there is war. And the second aspect, Ukraine is not stable. The war started with the Revolution of Dignity, and the state institutions were not able to find answers to all questions. That's why it resulted in revolution. One more negative aspect is Chernobyl. Chernobyl is clearly associated with Ukraine, but this association is negative. And Japan also suffered Fukushima case, and there are some similarities. There is some empathy due to this. There is more understanding that this may happen in any country, because Chernobyl case was connected to the Soviet Union, and they believed that this could happen only in the Soviet Union. But now, due to Fukushima, they understand that it may happen anywhere. So this negative aspect, these negative emotions, they should be overcome. And our respondent said that the issue of Chernobyl should be presented in a more creative way. And we go back to the problem about which Mr. Vinchenko wrote, that the history of Ukraine cannot be read without
у лісах чорнобильських нині говорять про те, що
some tranquilizers. We should speak more about Ukraine, about positive associations with Ukraine. And we have a rich history, rich culture, wonderful landscapes, and it was said a lot about our landscapes, about sunflower fields, about love tunnel, and Japanese like to travel in this area where it is, and also cuisine, borscht was mentioned in the interviews, and also embroidery shirt with its cultural code and historic heritage, but also embroidery shirt as an element of modern culture, fashion, and after the concert, the questions were raised to where the performers got these shirts, also barely Cossacks, because they are similar to samurais. I will continue maybe without presentation because it failed. Speaking about how we may use positive topics and what who can be used as ambassador of cultural diplomacy. This is not only about modernity, and really popular. Gensuke sisters are also popular, and they play wonderfully using banduras and also very popular taiho koki. Iman Markianovich Baryshka, who was a very well-known sumoist, one of the most popular during the long period of time until 2015, he was one of the most powerful sumoists in Japan. Also, Cossacks, Ivan Mazepa, Bogdan Khmelnytsky, Petrosa, Gaidachny. And also, there is similarity between Cossacks and samurais and the leaders and Ukrainian hetmans. So, you may take advantage of this information that we got during interviews. Also, tourism was an important topic despite COVID, and Japanese may like it here in Ukraine. Also, Ukrainian food, Chernobyl, and academic cooperation, scientific cooperation, and fashion. For example, embroidery shirts, they may become popular in Japan. Also, aspects that should be taken into account. We should take into account the necessity to improve planning. We mentioned some exhibitions in museums of Japan, and exhibitions are planned in 3 or 5 years, and we have a lower threshold of planning because budgeting process is different. That's why some problems appear. So we should have proper long-term planning. We should plan beforehand. And also we need to focus on positive messages, not negative messages. One more important aspect that was mentioned is the trust to the institutions of power. Japanese trust in their institutions of power, and they extrapolate these views on others. It is better to refer to the Ukrainians, to the ministry, and they should be able to get clear answers. Otherwise, Japanese will understand that they have no one to speak with here. And several other important points we may propose based on our research. This is the necessity to reinforce the image of modern European Ukraine, to overcome this perception of Ukraine to the Soviet Union, to have proper visual image, and your Japanese colleagues and representatives of diaspora, they propose the image of, for example, sunflower or With like the image of Sakura, for example, for Japan. So we should reinforce the cultural cooperation, classic music, opera, ballet, and also we should pay attention to history and geography of Ukraine and the relations with neighbors. Also, we spoke about anime, cosplay. One of aspects was that Rukavichka is popular. They make cosplay on this. And Ukrainian studies at the universities to have more students exchanges with Japan. And also films, cartoons with Japanese subtitles, because language is the key to many doors in Japan. If you have questions, I'm ready to answer. Thank you, Sergei. In order to sum up this diplomatic responses to this topic, I would like to say that we have low awareness. At the same time, we see this spread of Russian prism, and at the same time, we see positive attitude and request for positive messages. And I would like to ask Violeta, our respondent, who really contributed to this research, about this results. How could they be used in further planning in cultural diplomacy? We're speaking about the work of Ukrainian embassy in Japan. Thank you very much for your question. Thank you for this wonderful research. This is really important. We have been waiting for it for a long time, and we will use its results. I have several comments about the research, if you allow me. I would start with them, and then I will go to the answers to your questions. For 10 years, I have been researching relations between Ukraine and Japan, history, and also I believe that on the whole, we face such a situation that Japanese, they do not know a lot about Ukraine. I believe that Japan in the past, they have more political interests in Ukraine. When we study the first works in Ukraine, we see that this is about political topics. Council office in Odessa, they sent their reports to Japan. Then in 1930, we have some reports of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Ukraine. After establishing after independence, we see some interest to revolutions and then Crimean topic, and it is indicated in the report. When we look at Ukraine, we see cultural interest in Japan. In 1860, there were studies in Kharkiv and Kiev, and 1926, studies were started concerning Japan. They wanted to study culture of Japan. And also, Japanese society is rather a political one. And when we are speaking about some cultural phenomenon, for example, Borscht, Kogitaiko, Samoist, his father was from Ukraine, for common Japanese citizen who have no interest in politics, he associates Ukraine only with the Soviet past. It should be taken into account, and also we have an important task to shift this political focus of the media, of research, from political issues to cultural issues. And in this way, a common Japanese will get more information about Ukraine. And also, what should be the image of Ukraine in Japan? What should we promote? What items should be promoted? And in this context, I would like to mention that I agree with the conclusions of the research that we should develop an image of Ukraine as cool Ukraine as Japan did it, based on commonalities between and similarities between our countries. Tourism is important, cuisine, culture, history, because Japanese, they take interests in these areas. At the same time, I didn't find mentioning about technological potential of Ukraine, and Japan is one of the leading technological nations of the world. We know that we have cooperation in security starting 2016 between Ukraine and Japan. In Ukraine, the Ministry of Digital Transformation was created, and in Japan, this agency is only, they only plan to create such an agency. And we may have discussions concerning these topics, and there is Mr. Shibata, who lives in Ukraine. He has his own IT company, and he promotes IT image of Ukraine in Japanese media and blogs. And I believe that this is really an interesting area for cooperation. And we need to find out how to promote Ukraine in Japan, how we may use the results of this research. First of all, as it was mentioned by Mr. Ambassador, it is really important to use social media in Japan. And Mr. Hirano Takashi also focused on this in private and public discussions. And we understood that this works. We have two accounts, Facebook and Twitter. We use these instruments in order to promote positive news and about trends in Ukraine. And we have chain reaction. We have many requests from the media that started to get interest in Ukrainian culture, and our news are not only about Crimea and Donbas. We have many items concerning culture, and on TV and in the media, in printed media. This is really important. Also, in this research, it is said that Ukrainian studies should be established in universities of Japan, and the negotiation was started on this. But there is such an issue as a request concerning Ukrainian studies and Ukrainian language studies. Students should see Ukraine on TV, through social media. We should ignite this interest. Otherwise, this won't work, because first you should get financing for all of this. And also, we spoke about food, restaurants, and Ambassador Kostrowski spoke about this. In Japan, there are restaurants of different countries. They actively use Ukrainian dishes. It is weird why in so many years they didn't manage to open a Ukrainian restaurant. The embassy supports this idea. We will provide maximum support for opening, because for Japanese, this is really important. The third area is work with business. I focused my attention on the fact that during this research, there were no representatives of business. Maybe these could be representatives of Japanese corporations in Ukraine or some companies here in Japan that deal with promotion of foreign products. For example, there is such a network as Don Quixote, or kind of shop that specializes in foreign products. Maybe as a continuation of this research, we should have interviews with them, and also embassy is actively working in this area. Also, we may include the representatives of tourism agencies, because we speak about tourism a lot, and when we overcome this pandemic, this area of cooperation will be intensified. Really important are cultural events. we have opportunity to hold them online, or these may be events based on the internet platforms. For example, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Ukraine, Dmytro Kuleba, launched a site, Ukraine UA. This is the first official site, and we held an information campaign on social media, and we addressed a number of our partners and asked to place information about the site and their resources, and we really are thankful to JICA and also our partners from Mario Yokogama, Hino, and also cultural associations of Japan that cooperate with Ukraine. Also, our communities placed this information, and it was really important to translate the site into Japanese because you know that there is specificity of this language. And also, we hope to hold these cultural events offline here in Japan. And in this context, it is really important to have joint efforts, because in the recommendations, many times the work to actualize is mentioned, and we need money for this, we need budget for this, and we need human resources, because there are some projects that do not need financing, but human resources are needed. So this is time of people who will deal with this. And we, as an embassy, we work 100%, and we believe that it is really important that the state institutions be involved, in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the Ukrainian Institute, and Friends of Ukraine in Japan. Mr. Hirame wrote a wonderful book, this book is really popular. You may buy it through Amazon, and we saw it in many libraries and also in the bookshops. So such efforts, they are really important for us.
This is also the work of our ambassadors of culture, their activity. You mentioned Katerina Gudzi, Natalia Gudzi, Stepanyuk. There are people who actively promote Ukraine, also Ukrainian community. We are grateful for their efforts. Thank you for attention. If you have questions, I will be happy to answer. Thank you. It's very interesting. We can see that the Embassy of Ukraine in Japan has many plans, and you probably will be expanding your activity. In the end, I will request Sergei to react to that. But now we would like to give the floor to the agents of culture, people who create some cultural projects. I mean, Andriy Kurkov, who is a famous Ukrainian writer, who's published actively in Japan. In the beginning, the ambassador mentioned how book is important in Japanese culture. The question to you is, how to present Ukrainian literature to Japanese reader? Do you follow any changes in how Ukraine is perceived in Japan? Good afternoon. I cannot say that I'm following the changes in the attitude to Ukraine, but I regularly see Japanese who are interested in Japan, in Ukraine, sorry. And when I was there in 2015, after my book, The Diary of Maidan, was published in Japan, I visited Japan. I realized that Japanese politicians are interested in Japan, in Ukraine. I know that books about Ukraine were published in Japan. There was small reports of Olga Yakovenko. She lived in Japan for 13 years. She received a doctorate degree in Japanese university. But talking about literature, Japanese are very open and they read a lot of foreign literature. Unfortunately, there's not so many Ukrainian books there. But in Japan, There are no international festivals like there are in the US or in Europe. Most often universities organize such events, and very often the students are reading foreign literature. And our task would be to attract more Japanese students to Ukrainian history or culture in the context of Eastern Europe or in the context of Europe. Japan is a wonderful country, and as the ambassador said, that's another planet which is very specific, and we need to understand it. There was such an idea of Ukrainian cartoons. If they are prepared for a demonstration in Japan, that's great. But when you think about Japan, you need to look further. If we, for example, do the Japanese dubbing of the forest fairy, then we need to find the Japanese craftsmen who will make the dolls, and then this cartoon will stay with the Japanese culture. It should be done so that people can take Ukraine into their hands. If a Japanese child takes Ukrainian doll in their hands, then this will be like planting the interest to Ukrainian culture for the future. I know that Japanese literature is very popular in Europe and in our country, though in Europe it has reached, it's been widely disseminated and there are many readers. But here we can also work more on bilateral contacts, and we can invite Japanese writers via the Embassy of Japan to Ukraine. There are many students who were studying Japanese in Ukraine. When I was studying Japanese back in my students' years, there was just one place where you could learn it, you can study it. Now I meet many students who know well Japanese. Talking about social media, I would provoke these students to be more active and to create some online clubs or Facebook pages with Japanese, together with Japanese about Ukraine. These contacts on a personal level, on level of students, are very important. Russia is very famous in Japan because of their movies and culture. As soon as there was, as the Soviet Union could promote Russian culture, they, in Japan, there were immediately clubs organized, the Berezka, which is Birch Tree, and immediately Japanese started studying Russian language and got interested in Russian culture. We need to think of what to do, how to organize such clubs of Ukrainian culture. Culture, it's not just literature, but music and painting in Japan. I remember when there was an exhibition of Mykola Zhuravel, Ukrainian painter, in Japan. Immediately there was a high interest to Ukrainian art, and he has become like a cult painter, artist. It was his personal achievement, which Ukraine didn't make use of, because the embassy didn't know probably about that. But now when we have such active diplomats, then I believe that the embassy should follow, should monitor these things, and should promote any success of Ukrainian representative in Japanese culture. The difference, the distance is great between us. we will have to fly over Russia in both senses so that we can reach Japan. But I believe there are good prospects. We need to think of some projects together and encourage Ukrainian students to more actively work in the projects, to be involved in some online activities so that they work and disseminate the knowledge about Japan and Ukraine and the knowledge about Ukraine and Japan. Thank you, Andriy, for your very interesting reflections. And now I would like to give the floor to Mr. Takashi Hirano, who was mentioned several times already. This is the person who very actively promotes Ukraine and Japan and Japan and Ukraine. And Mr. Takashi mentioned that he read our survey and he has some thoughts about that. But I also would like to ask you, in work with Japan, we need to actively take into account the specifics of culture. Mr. Korsunsky was talking about how important it is to know Japanese language. Maybe you can mention some other cultural specific features which we need to take into account when cooperating with Japan. Good afternoon. Thank you for invitation. Today I will be speaking from another planet. It's a very high quality survey, and I thank for what you have done. And it's clear that the main part of the conclusions is that Japanese know very little about Ukraine, and that is because there's very little information about Ukraine and Japan. Most people don't know in Japan about Ukraine. They don't know even where Ukraine is. And it is very important to understand that the target audience of cultural diplomacy should be those people who do not know about Ukraine, not those who know about Ukraine, because proportionally, the majority are those who do not know about Ukraine. And by the way, you mentioned that it's bad that people don't know about Ukraine, and also it's bad that the Russian influence is very big. But I believe these two factors are interrelated. I believe that people, because there's little information about Ukraine, people receive most of the information from Russia. But if there's more information from Ukraine, then this problem would be addressed, I believe. So basically, we need to work on enhancing the awareness about Ukraine and Japan. That's task number one. And also, the lack of knowledge about Ukraine is a drawback, but on the other hand, this could be an advantage as well, because that means that there's no stereotypes as to Ukraine. 2 days ago, during another event of Ukrainian Institute, it has been mentioned that in the Great Britain there's a stereotype that everything is not tasty in Great Britain, or the Germans are not joyful people. That's such a stereotype. And as to Russia, there's a stereotype that it's very dangerous in Russia. Maybe partially that's true, but that is exaggeration. And there's no stereotype as to Ukraine in Japan, and that could be an advantage. Generally speaking, what to do to make Ukraine more known? I agree with the conclusions of your survey. But there are certain specific features that you asked about, and today I'd like to talk about that. It is very important to research how Ukraine is perceived in Japan, and parallel to that, it is very important to study how information is perceived in general in Japan, not just information about Ukraine. What is specific about that? What are the trends in the information space of Japan? And the content should be adapted to such understanding. Very often, I believe, there are contents which Ukraine believes are good are perceived differently in Japan. And to avoid that, we need to research how Japanese perceive which content, what would be the efficient way of presentation in Japan. And I would like to offer certain things. First of all, Japanese language, and you've mentioned it many times. It is important that people will not perceive information in English, but they will perceive in Japan, Japanese. Also, you need to understand how effective the social media are. Now, Twitter is the most efficient one to transfer information. Third, visualization of content, photographs, video, and animation, and the pictures in manga style, because we're used to perceiving information with the assistance of animation. When this is something complicated, like a history of another country, the history of Crimea or Ukrainian literature, then we wouldn't start reading some thick books, but we would like to learn something, to learn from some concised information. And the fourth is understanding that this is not the work, not just for the embassy, but for all those who are interested in the process, all people who live in Ukraine or in Japan and who study Japanese, and also the director of analyst that soft power is not just the responsibility of the government. The ambassador said that those in Ukraine who study Japanese, they need to talk, to tell about Ukraine in Japanese language. And this way, the image of Ukraine will be enhanced. And another good example would be first tweet of Mr. Ambassador Korsunsky on Twitter. He just showed his photograph with the mace and wrote, "I'm the ambassador of Ukraine. I have come recently to Japan, and nice to meet you." And he wrote it in Japanese, and he received 46,000 likes and 17,000 retweets. You should understand why this became so popular in Japan. There's a key. No one expected such a reaction, but Japanese reacted very actively. I asked some people I know why you liked this tweet, and they said they didn't know about Ukraine, but the ambassador of this country said that nice meeting you, having some weapon, but he was smiling For them, that was a positive shock, and they got interested, and they started following him because they wanted to receive more interesting information. It is important to use these things. The fact that people don't know Ukraine, this could be used when, this fact could be used when you promote Ukraine. People are interested if it looks for them to be of some interest. And in the end, I would like to mention Ukrainian cuisine, because you mentioned Ukrainian cuisine many times. I agree that it's a very good cuisine, and it's good that the Embassy of Ukraine organized this competition on cooking the borscht, and I saw that in the results some of the Japanese made borscht, and they made photographs of borscht, and they started communicating. A famous Japanese expert, Olga Hemenka, showed the photographs of birds made of batter, and she explained that such birds are baked in the beginning of spring, and she received 6,000 likes, and Japanese started baking such birds. And they were saying that, yeah, I'm interested in Ukraine, I want to go to Ukraine. It's important to open the restaurant of Ukrainian cuisine, but it is very important to make people feel, to feel and to taste Ukrainian cuisine at home. You can enjoy Ukrainian cuisine. If you show the recipes, people will start making Ukrainian cuisine, and they will enjoy it. It will be very useful if the ambassador starts cooking some Ukrainian meals every month, and adds some Japanese elements into Ukrainian meals. Maybe someone will make borscht with wasabi. It will be an interesting case to communicate with the Japanese audience. On that, I will stop. Okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Takashi. And at the end, I would like to bring back a discussion to Mr. Sinchuk, because we had this explosion of different ideas and thoughts about this research and perception of Ukrainian culture in Japan. Maybe you have some personal reflections of this, but I would like to speak about Mr. Takashi's argument. This lack of awareness may be also a plus for promotion of some cultural program of Ukraine in Japan. Do you believe this is a plus or the minus? And also Mr. Kurkov said that we may fly over Russia right to the hearts of Japanese people. First of all, I would like to thank for these reflections on our research. All of them were positive, and this is really good that we were able to satisfy these needs of those who ordered this research, and also more broader audience about awareness about Ukraine. I would like to provide an answer to what Mr. Takashi Hirano said and Violet said, and we should raise awareness, and we should not provide negative information, negative image, and this negative image belongs to the perception of Ukraine through Soviet Union, and Violeta mentioned that it's not enough, the financial and human resources are not enough, and this is a problem. But from what I heard from our respondents in the course of the research, even this lack is compensated by relations between people, and they continue the dialogue. I won't mention the names, but all the interviews were done due to those prominent figures, those stars. They may lead others. They have good reputation here in Ukraine and in Japan, and I'm really satisfied with the Ukrainian diaspora in Japan. This is a small diaspora. This is not like our diaspora in Canada, US, or in Poland, but the potential of these people should be used. And they really want to contribute to the development of relations between our country in a positive key. This is a wonderful note to end up our discussion. We thank all the participants, all the panelists. And I would like to remind to you that this research may be downloaded from the page of Ukrainian Institute, both in Ukrainian and in English, depending on the language you need. So at 3, we will have one more presentation. This time, this will be the case of Turkey. Till the next time.